Good evening. Welcome to this interaction on the skilling challenges that we face. We have a panel with two people, one who is still in the establishment, one who was recently, till recently in the establishment, who will provide perspectives on what is clearly, at least in my scheme of things, one of the top three, if not the top challenge that the country is going to have to address. We're all familiar with the numbers, and I don't want to repeat them, other than to re-emphasize the number of 1 million jobs per month, you know, give or take a few. When you get to those kinds of magnitudes, accuracy is hardly, you know, critical. But I like to visualize this in as a sort of triangle, three separate sets of issues coming together. There is the process of job creation itself. What is doing that? What processes within the economy are helping to create jobs? The second is what Mr. Ramadurai has been focused on for the last few years. 5 years, is it? Or longer? Okay. on how do you create the skills appropriate to the jobs that are being created, assuming that they are being created. And the third, which is a sort of, I'd say, somewhat underemphasized dimension, at least in the realm of non-agricultural jobs, is the safety net. Because when we're talking about markets, and the power of market forces to provide employment solutions, we also have to think in terms of, you know, the welfare aspect of flexible labor markets. So we have hardly spent any time on discussing non-rural safety nets, and I think that's a discussion that needs to be taken forward. But maybe this is not the the occasion on which to do that. So here, I think we're talking about two things, essentially, the two sides of that, two of the three sides of that triangle, where are the jobs coming from, and how are we ensuring that people develop the right types of skills. There has to be both what I'd call a spatial matching, which is that the skills and the jobs have to be in the same place, and there's also a temporal matching, which is the skills have to be created in time for the jobs. We have, I think, to me, a very powerful illustration of this problem in the episode of the Polish plumbers in the UK, when, as a result of rapidly rising wages for plumbers, some 40,000 Britons enlisted or enrolled into plumbing school around the time when Poland joined the EU, and, you know, people from Poland migrated to the UK. A lot of them being plumbers. So by the time these people graduated from plumbing school, I think it's a two-year program, they were unemployed. So, you know, the time consistency of the job market was being tested. So this is the canvas. We have Mr. Ramadurai, of course, we have Mr. Mehra. Ajit is an economist working for a large conglomerate spread across many, many sectors. From very labor-intensive to very capital-intensive, and I think that perspective on where the jobs come from, you know, how is industry dealing with the challenge of, or you know, how does industry view employment? Is it labor? Is it skills? What combination? And across sectors. And Shamika is going to talk about some research linking the larger macroeconomic, the growth process, to job creation. So we hope to get a very rounded perspective here. Maybe 5-7 minutes each for opening remarks. I know that many of you have time constraints, so we'd like to wind up by about 8:30. Okay, so you can, you know, whenever convenient, but after having answered a few questions, of course.
Well, thank you, Subir. Thanks, Vikram, for organizing this. I think, as you have correctly articulated, it's a scale problem for sure, whether it's 1 million or 500,000 or 750,000, doesn't matter, because the scale is so large that anything we achieve is going to be insufficient. That's the starting point. But at the same time, we need to think big. And if you have to think big, then you have to think implementation as much as a simple strategy or an institutional mechanism. Implementation is a completely different ball game because you need to get into the nitty-gritty, you need to get into the details, and you need to collaborate in a big way because you just cannot do sitting in Delhi for a problem that needs to be solved in, let's say, Bihar. I think we got to engage with the local people, committed people who believe in implementation, through impact measurements. Implementation, the single most important thing is what is the measure? What are the set of measures and how do we track that and how do we keep improving on that metrics on a continuous basis? Now the point which Subir addressed with regard to the matching, the critical thing is, the first thing is, can I find a job or an entrepreneurship opportunity in the place I belong to or I want to be in? Second is, what is the next level of migration I am willing to do within the same state or within a certain radius, and what are the kind of opportunities I can create for myself? The third is, if I go out, is it sufficiently engaging as well as from a wage perspective, does it make sense for me to migrate? I came across an individual, which I keep repeating, is this person came to repair a television set, a Sony one, last week. And then he was extremely good at repairing the TV. He did a perfect job, both in terms of ability, in terms of identifying, replacing the board, packing his tools back, and then producing a bill, giving you the warranty, then saying that he can collect pay by check, etc., etc., completed the whole transaction end to end. Now he has got 12 years of experience after graduating from a polytechnic in a recognized institution, and he has been engaged by Akai or Sony or one of the Sony dealers in Philips, and 12 years of experience. And he works in Bombay, and the amount of money he gets is 10,000 rupees a month. Now that's a completely mismatch and a completely unacceptable kind of employment which we have generated, even though the kid was exceptionally good. I think so the job creation at the place and job enablement as the migration takes place with the right kind of wages, but for the right kind of skills, is very important. How do we do that is through what we call as the sector skill councils, which we have currently through the National Skill Development Corporation. 30 sector skill councils and mapping of the jobs within those sectors is the responsibility of the sector skill council. When I say mapping of the jobs, it means what are the levels at which the competency can be defined. We have done from level 1 through 10, where you start in the school level at about level 1, namely in the secondary school. And then you can get a bachelor's degree in vocational stream at the end of level 10, with alternate pathways from the general education to the vocational or vocational to general education. The responsibility of the sector skill councils also to produce what we call as the national occupation standards with the qualification packs for those occupations. When I say qualification packs, is the number of hours with the content to say that if you do this many hours with this content with this particular thing, you will be certified and you can take a certification examination, and then ability to perform a certain function or a certain job role which is defined, like I said, through the occupation standards. From a supply side, we have faced a number of challenges with regard to anything from basic mobilization, because we have problems of dropout, we have problems of people coming for the right area in which they want to be skilled, and appropriateness, because it has to be at the place where you want to get employed. So rural employment, maybe an agricultural tractor maintenance, a driver, some of the other plumbers, etc., etc. What are those local jobs which make sense, or local entrepreneurship opportunities? The mindsets also, where the parents as well as the students feel getting a BA or a BCom or a BSc degree is better than getting a plumbing degree or a welding degree or a welding diploma. And how do you overcome that? So we have put certain mechanisms at the National Skill Development Corporation or through the National Skill Development Agency, engaging some of the brightest minds to put together television, radio, talk shows, or posters, etc., etc. But the scale of that is so huge that it's going to take a fair amount of time before bringing the right people. I think the simple measure where I think I would also blame the IT industry to some extent, 20,000 people applied, which chose 2. I think it was a completely wrong measure. I would rather have 20 people apply and then 2 people selected, because it's a better matrix, because the right kind of people are coming into it. So that the remaining ones go to the other professions or where it is needed, where they like it. Simply rejecting a guy is not a great measure. Accepting a guy is a better measure. So how do you get that acceptance with the right thing so that they pass out? Because they work with a passion, they work with a interest, and they are hopefully going to do much better than somebody else. I think we have done a lot of studies in terms of demand supply in a particular sector, and that is done through third parties, independent agencies, etc., etc. And what has been the success? Because ultimately, if we are preaching measurement, we have to do measure ourselves. Through the Skills Development Corporation, we have funded about 136 partners to date, and scaled up a capacity that will be created over the next 10 years, starting 3 years ago or whatever it is, which means another 7 years. About 80 to 82 million people that will be trained or skilled. Out of that, we also put a minimum percentage that 70% of them should be placed either through entrepreneurship or employment at appropriate locations with the appropriate levels of competency. So I think we want to scale it up to about 150 million in the National Skill Development Corporation, which is a public-private initiative essentially, and the industry participation is pretty good here, because the sector skill councils are represented by the industry and the CEOs are there to completely drive it with funding from the National Skill Development Corporation, and we are going to be increasing the funding also if a lot of work needs to be done in all the areas I talked about. I think the Skill Development Authority, its responsibility is to look at from a policy perspective, measurement of implementation on the ground, doing some of the pilots, rolling out the National Skills Qualification Framework, and then enabling the government mechanisms, where about 21 ministries are involved in the skill development itself, where the challenges are, where most of the issues are, and what are the kind of issues which are there. Is there are no outcome measurements. They may have 76 schemes between the 21 ministries, but there is no outcome measure today. How do you get them to a single outcome measure, as an example, so that it's a challenge to get the outcome measure? Second is reporting, and reporting the right way through a digitized system where systems are completely missing. So how do you put those systems both within internally to the ministry and across ministries where some of the skills? For example, a rural development and an urban development, why should they not have some same set of skilling programs are there? Or the modular employability schemes. The Apprenticeship Act, as an example, if it does not get touched, then you will not get the industry to accept the apprentices, because it's very draconian in nature. So we are working with the Labor Department on a long-term basis. The education is a concurrent list. It's a state subject. So how do you get these schools to adopt, whether it's a CBSE, ICSE, or any other medium school, with the skills and vocational education as part of the curriculum itself, so that the children get to do that early on in the game? And sectorally, manufacturing is important, services are important, the migration from agriculture to these becomes very, very necessary, and how do you do those transitions? I think what we have achieved in 2.5-3 years is putting these institutional mechanisms in place, started, like I said, through the NSDC, the funding and the capacity we have created, and some of the policy measures to measure things, but the systems are just getting developed, and it will get rolled out as we move on. But I think the challenges have been, like I said, collaboration. Challenges have been measurements. Challenges in terms of advocacy and finding the local jobs where nobody has done the map. The detailing is what is critical. The devil is in the details, and that's why we are trying to push. I mean, even simple thing like if, for example, the industry is willing to commit volunteers. I think, let's say, I want 100 volunteers as the field force on the ground. The corporate India is willing to fund those, because if I give a 1 year sabbatical for an employee in the office, there's no process or no mechanism in the government to employ them for 1 month, 1 year, whatever it is. There are certain rules prescribed where I cannot have more than 7 interns maximum. How can you do this kind of job with 7 interns when they say I don't have the money or whatever it is? So I think the Apprenticeship Act I talked about, the internship I talked about, having the kind of people we want, measurement systems, these are the challenges. So the scale problem can be solved provided we put these right people, right process, right systems, measurements, and continuously track what we are doing. But continuously revisit these details. You cannot have, like the welding example you mentioned. You can't take, the plumbing you mentioned. You can't take 2 years and then find that those jobs are no longer needed. So we have to find methods where you train faster. So how do you do that? We bring in some simulators which we have built in partnership with some of the institutions where I can compress the time frame but at the kind of quality you can get. Digital platform, digital learning, using the broadband, etc., the role of technology in all of these things. I think there'll be a million experiments, million initiatives, but at the end of the day, all of them must synergize together wherever possible. One of the roles we perform is where you connect these pieces together and see what we do. You must be prepared for some shocks where it may not succeed, but at the end of the day, we think we are on the right path. That's the way I'd like to summarize. Thank you.